Social media has created quite a following over the past decade. People all over the world are tweeting and scanning Facebook pages, as well as countless other social media sites.
College athletes are some of the world's heaviest social media users. From player security to athletic department restrictions, we tackle these issues and much more coming up next on the OSU Sports Media Show. Welcome to this edition of the OSU Sports Media Show. I'm Mike Schaus.
And I'm Marissa Belzer. Today, we'll discuss a hot topic in college sports that is affecting universities across the country.
That's right, Marissa. Social media has played a huge role on and off the field in college athletics. Here at Oklahoma State University, coaches, athletes, and even fans have to follow social media policies set by the university's athletic department, individual coaches, and even the law.
First, we take a look at how collegiate and professional athletes use social media as a platform to brand themselves to the world. We send it over to Brandon, who has more on the story. Brandon?
Thanks, Marissa. Collegiate and professional athletes love to have the spotlight on their image on and off the field. Our investigative reporter, Garret Young, takes a look at the positives and negatives of athletes branding their image using social media.
Branding an image. Let's face it, many athletes are obsessed with becoming a household name. In today's media obsession with image, athletes turn to a new source to market themselves to the world, social media. Social media allows athletes to connect directly to their fans and a way for them to promote their image. Professional athletes generally have the ability to tweet about any topic. But at the collegiate level, many student athletes face limitations on how they can brand themselves to the world. Kevin DeShazo, founder of Fieldhouse Media, focuses on teaching student athletes proper social media use to promote their institution and their careers.
What we tell student athletes is come up with 4 to 5 identity words that define who you are as a person, and then figure out how can that message translate online. So if being a student athlete is part of your identity, maybe your faith is part of your identity, maybe technology or business, if you're a writer, figure out who you are as a person and then understand how that message translates online. And that's going to help them, A, help them as a student athlete endearing themselves to fans and to the media, but also as they move into a career, they've got a platform that they've built, and including positive social media use.
Dr. Jimmy Sanderson, assistant professor at Clemson University, says athletes can further brand themselves by selling tweets to corporate sponsors.
Well, I think it's a tremendous tool for any athlete to brand themselves. So I think every athlete should be using it in some fashion as a branding tool. If you're an athlete, you can then take that to a sponsor or a corporate client and say, hey, I've got 130,000 Twitter followers, I'll tweet. Here I am driving my Ford truck. Here's my, you know, Rolex watch. Here's my, you know, I'm drinking a Pepsi. You know, whatever. And I think we talked about monetizing Twitter. I think that's one way that athletes can do it.
DeShazo says you don't have to stray too far away from former and current Oklahoma State athletes using good social media.
A lot of good examples. From the Oklahoma State perspective, Ricky Fowler, I think, does a great job, as well as Hunter Mahan. Most of the OSU golfers on tour, I think, do a terrific job of being themselves. Right? They have fun, they engage fans, they interact. Brandon Whedon, when he was here, did a great job. He still does a great job in Cleveland. Even though he's under a lot more scrutiny, he's still figured out a way to use social media well. On campus right now, I think Clint Shelf, that's an easy answer, but I think he does a pretty good job of representing the program well, being the face of a big-time football program. I think he does a great job.
OSU quarterback Wes Lunt has had to deal with fake Twitter accounts using his name. Lunt says he doesn't want these fake accounts to ruin his image.
You know, kind of during the summer, those fake accounts came out, and Gavin and I just kind of sat down and just said, hey, do you want to make a real account just to show who, you know, this is your account, this is you talking, this kind of stuff. Obviously, I don't use it very much. I don't even think I have the password for it, to be honest.
Athletes often forget to think before they tweet. DeShazo says it is important for athletes to remember that not only will friends see their social media use, but also the whole world has access to it.
There's a lot of issues we've seen with student athletes using it poorly, and most of it comes from not understanding the power of social media and realizing it's more than just you and your friends talking. It's more than you and your 400 or 500, couple thousand followers. It's literally the world. And so everything you say online, you're having a press conference with every tweet. So understanding the messages that you're putting out, the impact that those can have, making sure that you're making positive, appropriate decisions.
As social media grows more powerful by the day, athletes will continue to brand themselves on these outlets for years to come. For O-State TV, I'm Garrett Young.
It will be interesting to see whether collegiate and professional athletes will use social media for personal use or as a way to brand themselves to the world. Mike?
Thanks, Brandon. The safety of a collegiate athlete off the field is a major priority for an athletic department. Our own Marissa Belzer takes a look at how social media can jeopardize the safety of an athlete out in public.
Social media. Whether it's Twitter or Facebook, almost every student athlete has one. Along with those social media networks comes hundreds of followers and plenty of mentions. While Twitter may be a great way for student athletes to interact with their fans, some athletes tend to give a little too much information, which could jeopardize their safety. Kevin DeShazo, founder of Fieldhouse Media, says athletes need to think about their tweets before they post them.
As a student athlete, you're going to have thousands of people potentially following you because they want access to you. So you just have to be mindful that those people are out there, and most have perfectly good intentions, but there are always a few who don't. So being mindful of what you're tweeting and what information you're putting out there that could put you in a harmful situation.
Some athletic programs monitor the athlete's use of social media with hope of keeping the athlete safe. However, too harsh of monitoring has led to several states proposing the Social Networking Online Protection App, or SNOPA for short. According to Fieldhouse Media, SNOPA won't allow athletic departments to have a student athlete turn over their password to a social network, require athletes to log on in front of a coach or administrator, require athletes to befriend their coaches or accept the coach's request to follow them on Twitter, use monitoring software, or use an athlete's friend page to monitor the athlete's page. Although Oklahoma State University hasn't had many problems with privacy invasion or the safety of their athletes because of social media, safety of social media is still discussed.
Me and my coach, we always have conversations about it, you know, what to post and what not to post. So, and me, I like Twitter, but I don't really tweet that much, so unless I'm like retweeting somebody.
Other student athletes take it upon themselves to make the right decisions before sending out a tweet.
You know, I try and kind of regulate, you know, think about everything before I hit send. So, that's one thing that I always try to do is think about, you know, the consequences of something that I say. So, I try and do that and make sure that, you know, there's no bad repercussions.
While some student athletes may not be tweeting their exact location, an app on their phone might be doing it for them. All iPhones have a location device inside them, which some Twitter applications like Echophone use to pinpoint the exact location if left turned on.
Most coaches don't understand it. That's something that we will mention in our sessions, is turn off your location. That doesn't mean to not ever tweet where you are. If you're going somewhere interesting, tweet that you're going there. But you don't need to have your location turn on at all times. People just don't generally need to know where you are.
Turning off the location aspect of Twitter is simple. With only a few taps, no one will be able to see the exact location of where a tweet was made, which could prevent student athletes from potential danger. As social media continues to evolve, the safety of student athletes will continue to remain a topic of conversation. For O-State TV, I'm Marissa Belzer.
When we come back, we will go out for a live report at Boone Pickett Stadium for an in-depth look at how the Oklahoma State Athletics Compliance Office deals with social media.
Also, many potential high school recruits deal with fans using social media in attempts to persuade them to commit to a certain college. Could you be one of those fans? It's time for a quick Twitter break. We'll be right back after this. Welcome back. When a five-star athlete makes an official visit to a college campus, the social media networks light up with potential recruiting violations. Fans often try to do whatever they can to persuade these high school wonders to commit to their school. Haley Martin takes a deeper look into this ever-changing issue.
The process of recruiting high school athletes within the boundaries of NCAA regulations has been the headache of college coaches for ages. But in recent years, the rise of the internet and social media has made an added pressure for recruits and coaches who are trying not to get violations.
You know, there are some times where the NCAA rules, you know, they do to the average person seem ridiculous, but they're there for a reason. And you don't want, you know, thousands of people creating all these Facebook pages and inundating these kids with requests and pestering them to death. You know, they just need to go through the recruiting process with just the coaches and the student athlete or the recruits and their parents. And if you get outside influences, that's when things, you know, start getting ugly.
Outside influences such as fans, alumni, and donors of the university have gotten involved on Twitter and started tweeting directly at high school athletes trying to persuade them to sign with their schools. The University of Notre Dame's compliance department made a video to discourage people from doing this.
NCAA rules are clear.
Only coaches can recruit on behalf of Notre Dame.
It's against the rules for you to contact prospects or their families about Notre Dame.
In person, by telephone, or online.
Through Twitter or Facebook. When boosters violate NCAA rules,
the university is accountable. The university is accountable.
When five-star recruit Laquan Treadwell visited Oklahoma State University's campus in January, Twitter was buzzing about this potential new cowboy.
Laquan was really interesting to watch because, building up, you know, he was going to come here, he's coming for a visit, all this, that whole week, he was all the chatter. You'd see all kinds of people, hey, you're going to love it here, be sure you're stopping by to check this out, which on the surface is nice. You know, it's good that our fans are that into it, that they want to, you know, share their experiences and try to promote our school. But the NCAA does say that that's an NCAA violation, recruiting violation, which granted, that's too out of control. There's no way they could really control that. Without just completely being over the top harsh.
While it is highly unlikely that a fan tweeting at a recruit would get the university in trouble, it is still a very real violation.
If it's just like, say, a random person who's doing it and has no real ties to Oklahoma State, there's not going to be a penalty involved. If it's someone that's, you know, connected to the institution, a booster or something like that, then there could be penalties such as you can't call the recruit for a set period of time. It could be where they take away contacts or evaluations from the coaching staff, it could go as serious as not being allowed to recruit that prospect anymore.
There are, however, two sides to the story on social media. In a St. Louis Today article, both the positives and negatives of social media are weighed. Nate Latch says, at their best, social media sites can be used by college prospects as a tool for helping them get noticed. At their worst, they become an avenue through which fans, most often adults, can send hateful messages toward those same prospects.
The NCAA can continue to make regulations that the universities have to abide by. That doesn't mean that the fans will follow the rules. For O-State TV, I'm Haley Martin.
Thanks, Haley. Marissa, I can see why coaches across the country pray that fans don't go too far when a recruit comes to campus.
Yeah, definitely. It's hard to control what some of those rowdy fans will put on their Twitter accounts.
Indeed it is. We turn our focus to the Athletic Compliance Office, which has seen its job duties do a complete turnaround since the social media boom. We send it out live to Boone Pickens Stadium, where Evan Farbach has more on this story. Evan?
When action returns to Boone Pickens Stadium in the fall, NCAA compliance officers will definitely have their hands full teaching student athletes how to handle social media.
Social media and college athletics. It wouldn't seem like the two have anything to do with each other. But in the ever-changing world of strict recruiting violations and emerging ways for people to communicate on a variety of different platforms, well, the NCAA and college compliance offices have their work cut out for them.
I first started in compliance in 2002 at the University of Oklahoma. I was an intern for 2 years. So I've been doing it pretty solid since then, and obviously compliance staffs in 2002 were one- or two-man shops, and now you're looking at, we've got a staff of 7, and we're probably average for the conference. Some of the conference schools have as many as 10 to 12.
Having all these social media outlets can be advantageous early on to college coaches recruiting student athletes. But Oklahoma State compliance officials admit monitoring all these interactions can sometimes be a hassle.
And obviously technology has changed quite a bit, and it's hard for the NCAA to stay ahead of the curve. You know, there are some times where the NCAA rules, you know, they do to the average person seem ridiculous, but they're there for a reason.
Just back in January of 2013, the NCAA has begun to deregulate some of its strict rules. No longer are there dead periods for recruiting in college athletics, meaning coaches can contact players whenever and as often as they want. Experts in the field think other rules regarding contact with boosters and fans on social media will be reined in as well. Just this year, former Poke running back Thurman Thomas got OSU in some hot water with standout recruit Laquan Treadwell. He inadvertently committed a minor violation for reaching out to the recruit on Twitter. The OSU compliance office says there is only so much it can do.
What we do in those situations is we try to contact whoever the page administrator is and try to work with them to help understand that, one, they're putting us in jeopardy, and two, they're also, in some instances, putting the student athlete in jeopardy. So we just kind of respectfully ask that you guys take that down. In a few instances, we've worked directly with Twitter and Facebook and their administrators.
Recruiting violations aren't the only issue that social media arises. Coaches and players can get themselves into bad situations in a variety of other ways, leaving collegiate compliance offices taxed. The NCAA has already changed its rules regarding social media on many different levels. Some may wonder how the NCAA can get away with so much regulation. Aren't there First Amendment issues at hand? OSU professor Joey Sennett explains that, although bureaucratic, the NCAA isn't the government.
It can regulate without violating the First Amendment the speech of its members, because it's a voluntary association by the universities. The difference would be the university, if it's a state university, would try to be controlling the student, and government then would be directly involved in controlling the speech by the student.
When action returns to Boone Pickens Stadium in the fall, NCAA compliance officers will have their hands full teaching student athletes how to deal with social media. From Boone Pickens Stadium, I'm Evan Farbach.
Thanks, Evan. When we come back, we catch up with a few Oklahoma State coaches from a variety of sports on how they deal with their student athletes' usage of social media.
Also, we will have a roundtable discussion on ways how to handle social media issues and what we can expect for the future of college athletics dealing with tweeting.
At Oklahoma State University, we put community before commercialism, leadership before showmanship. We prefer ideas over ideologies. We'd rather make a difference before we make a headline. We're all about bright minds, building brighter futures, and the brightest world for all. And we're proud to wear America's brightest orange.
Coaches are often the ones fretting over what their student athletes may post online. Some coaches around the country consider a social media ban, while others consider a less dramatic approach. Our own Mike Schaus has more on this story.
Social media has become embedded into our society. You can't step out of your house without seeing people on their smartphones, tablets, or computers browsing their social media sites. For the average college student, social media is used to keep up with friends and receive news. But for college athletes, they're playing with a different set of rules. Players across the country are receiving punishment for their use of social media outlets. Some schools have banned their players from using social media altogether. Kevin DeShazo of Fieldhouse Media, a company which provides social media education and monitoring, says schools are trying a variety of ways to protect their athletes and programs.
Some will keep it in-house, and what they'll do is they'll use programs like Hootsuite or TweetDeck, and they'll follow their own players on Twitter, and they'll friend student athletes on Facebook, and then they'll put them in a list on Hootsuite or TweetDeck so they can see what they're saying at all times on Twitter.
Here at Oklahoma State, head coach Colin Carmichael of the women's soccer team is one who used to ban athletes from social media, but now has changed his position.
We allow our kids to have their Facebook and Twitter accounts and things like that, and we just monitor them pretty closely to make sure that they're, you know, not saying things that could be taken the wrong way or maybe inappropriate for athletes and things like that.
DeShazo agrees that athletic programs need to watch over their athletes.
On some level, you have to be monitoring. And maybe that just means following them, right? Just at the very, at the most basic level, just following them on Twitter and seeing what they're doing, what they're saying, because they're representing not only themselves, but the university as well.
OSU men's tennis head coach Jay Udwadia is not concerned with his players' social media usage as long as they are educated in proper etiquette.
We try to stress, you know, only post things that are proper and appropriate. So if you do that, if you educate the players, I don't see it, if it's going to be a big problem. I think there's more pluses than negatives.
Jared Womack, a former baseball player here at OSU, remembers the instructions he was given by the sports information directors and his coaches.
Our coach had numerous meetings with us about how, you know, someone would put, you know, up a posting about insinuating they were drinking or out at the bars. But they basically said, listen, don't put anything up like that. Keep it professional. Make people look at you at a higher standard than your typical college student.
With all these athletes at universities using social media sites, who should get the final say on policy and punishment for misuses? At Oklahoma State, individual team coaches get to decide their team's protocol, and Coach Carmichael agrees.
Our kids are very different from the men's basketball team. I mean, as far as what they do and their social activities and things like that. So, I mean, I think you have to leave some of that leeway up to the coaches to determine what's appropriate or not, and also what kind of repercussions will be if you don't stick to the guidelines.
DeShazo doesn't approve of different policy for teams at the same university. He says problems can arise with separate treatment.
At the least, it should be a department level, not team level. When you've got so many different teams operating different ways, that's confusing for everybody, and why should a soccer player be treated differently than a softball player? They're both representing the university in a very public way when they're online.
DeShazo says banning student athletes from social media sites is an ineffective ploy. Students will find a way on their sites if they really want to, and there's no direct impact on the playing field. Oklahoma State had its greatest season ever with stars Brandon Whedon and Justin Blackman tweeting the entire season. Kansas, however, banned their students from using social media sites and only won 2 games. For OState TV, I'm Mike Schaus.
There is no shortage of opinion on whether athletic departments have the First Amendment right to ban social media.
Before we bring in our Daily O'Collegian sports reporters on this issue, we'd like to show a short excerpt from an interview with one of the leading experts in the country, Dr. Joey Sennett, to get his take on this First Amendment issue.
There are some states that have begun, the state legislatures have begun outlawing the requirement that you turn over your password for Facebook or Twitter or something to employers, to universities, so they can monitor your use. I can understand why an athletics coach would want to monitor and control to some degree, because it can become embarrassing. You know, they can embarrass themselves and the team. But I think that's probably better accomplished by educating the students to not say stupid things that they'll regret, to count to 20 if necessary before they tweet or put something on Facebook. But the First Amendment issue is that this is prior restraint by the government, and it really isn't about playing football or basketball. They could be tweeting on government, they could be criticizing government, they could be talking about any social issue, taking an advocacy point. And that raises some First Amendment issues about government control over students. Universities don't own students just because they're playing football or basketball or soccer or any other sport.
We would like to welcome our two Daily O'Collegian sports reporters to the show, James Poling and Jared Emerson. James, in light of the potential First Amendment issues raised by Dr. Sennett, what legal risk exists for athletic departments in attempting to manage student athletes' social media use?
Well, Marissa, there's been a handful of states that have passed social media privacy laws, and even more in the negotiation process in their respective houses and senates passing similar bills. Even the federal government, though who knows how long that will take, well, has its own similar bill coming up. And even though each varies by state and the federal government might overrule some of the details of this, coaches need to be aware of what's going on in these bills, because if they don't know, they might be violating laws such as installation of third-party monitoring systems on student athletes. They might not be allowed to force a student athlete to accept their friend request or follow them on Twitter. and private domain issues with student athletes, they have information that not the, the public can't see on Facebook, that's protected even from the coaches, unless the athlete chooses to disclose that. So the coaches need to be aware on what's going on in their respective states so they can avoid a First Amendment lawsuit potentially or and costly costs to the school, as well as bad publicity.
Most top universities invest millions in their athletes, with most schools making much more than they spend. Should individual coaches or the athletic programs as a whole get to monitor their athletes at all?
You know, Mike, I think it's extremely important that these universities monitor student athletes. Note how I didn't say ban. So, you know, social media is becoming such a big part of our society, and eventually these young men and women are going to leave their college athletic careers behind to pursue, you know, their professional careers. And athletic departments and coaches have this unique opportunity to train these student athletes on how to act on social media while in the spotlight. You know, banning them or not monitoring their movements on social media will only lead to more incidents, such as former Pittsburgh Steelers running back Rashard Mendenhall, who tweeted after Bin Laden was killed. In those tweets, he questioned 9/11, and he criticized people who were celebrating Bin Laden's death. You know, if a student athlete posts something like that, the athletic department can, you know, step in and use it as a learning experience so that he or she doesn't make the same mistake later down the road. You know, that said, I think monitoring needs to be done on a sports-by-sports basis rather than, you know, an athletic department-wide policy. As Colin Carmichael, the coach of the OSU women's soccer team, said, there's a huge difference between the quarterback of the football team and, you know, the forward for the women's soccer team. You know, the quarterback might need more monitoring or, you know, more restrictions because he's got 3,000 to 4,000 more followers than the soccer player, and to treat them, you know, exactly the same on social media, it's just it isn't fair.
Jared, you're absolutely right about monitoring. It's really important that the athletic department and the coaches know what their athletes are saying on social media. With that being said, I have to disagree with you. I believe they need to have some freedom of speech here, because when you look at it, it's still their personal accounts. If they're not the robots of the athletic department, they're not the robots of their coaches, leave the coaches to tweet out what they want to have about the program. These athletes, if they want to tweet out, hey, I played well against this person in video games, or I can't wait to see my friends tonight, they should have their own voice. And I believe it's key that they develop that own voice and not sound like, as I mentioned, a robot of the athletic department. So.
You know, James, schools invest millions in these athletes through scholarships, room and board, athletic training, weight training, and more, you know, and I'm not suggesting that they control what is said on social media, but I think it's more than fair to allow them to monitor the athletes, and if they see something that could potentially hurt the student athlete, the university, or the program, then they should be able to come in and say, hey, you know, this isn't something we agree with. You know, think about how others might take that tweet, even if it meant no harm, and, you know, let's fix it, and I think that's beneficial to all parties.
Then to add to that, with social media becoming increasingly more prevalent, how can the NCAA and individual athletic departments deal with fans using social media to attempt to recruit high school athletes to their favorite schools?
I'm not sure the NCAA can do much here, and I think they recognize that as well, and they've been accepting of some of these minor violations, to say the least. Obviously, boosters cannot contact potential high school recruits, and they could be punished because of that, but you don't see the T. Boone Pickens, the major donors of each individual schools, tweeting at so-and-so four-star recruit saying, hey, please come here, you're going to love it at Oklahoma State. It's usually the average Joe with minimal connection to the athletic department other than watching most of the games on his couch, looking at rivals.com throughout the day, seeing who's looking where, and maybe buying one or two tickets a year to go to games. And with no connection really to the athletic department, there's no consequence the athletic department can really offer that fan, like say, banning, like, hey, we can't ban, or you can't buy season tickets anymore, you can't donate anymore, we're going to remove your name from so-and-so statue. They can't do that to those average fans. And unable to do that, there's no consequence for the fan to stop tweeting at these recruits. And I think the NCAA recognizes how hard that is to enforce. And at the same time, there hasn't really been an instance where a high school recruit's like, hey, I'm gonna go. I went to the so-and-so school. I signed here because a random person I met said I like it here. You don't see that, and I think it's not worth the fight. And they've handled it well so far.
And Jared, your final thoughts?
You know, Marissa, when it comes down to it, some people, whether adults or college age, are gonna do dumb things. And when someone can sit behind the protection of a computer screen and say whatever they want, then I think you're gonna see the worst sides of people come out. My only suggestion would be, you know, almost like public shaming. Athletic departments and players should make an effort to let it be known that these type of people aren't associated with the beliefs of the fan, the universities, and the programs. you know, many of these tweeters probably consider themselves to be those diehard fans, you know, that really care about the program. So maybe if these athletic departments and players come out and distance themselves from these type of fans, it might have an impact on their thoughts.
Thank you, Jared and James, for that insight into this hot topic. Before we go, if you have any questions about the topics discussed in today's show, you can contact the School of Media and Strategic Communications at Oklahoma State University.
We would like to thank the Sports Media Program at Oklahoma State and ITLE for helping with this production. For the OSU Sports Media Show, I'm Marissa Belzer.
And I'm Mike Schausch, reminding you to think before you tweet.